All right. Good evening, everyone. My name is Christine Liu, and I'm the Assistant Director of Operations at The Basement. Today's event, called How to Get Funding for Your Startup, is part of The Basement's Entrepreneurial Toolkit series featuring speaker Salvador Dueñas. So Salvador Dueñas is the Senior Startups Manager at Future Founders, and in this role, he runs the Startup Bootcamp for 18 to 30-year-old founders in Chicago and across the country. So outside of Future Founders, Sal also supports the work at Chicago Blend, managing her program for aspiring venture capitalists. So before I turn it over to Sal, just want to go over some quick housekeeping items. This session is being recorded, so if you need to hop off for any reason, you can always view the whole video on our YouTube channel. And we kindly ask that you make sure you mute yourselves throughout the duration of the event. And without further ado, I turn it over to Sal.
Awesome. Well, really happy to be here. Fundraising is such an important topic in startups. I'm sure a lot of you have questions on how to do it, what's involved, how to find financing for your startups, and I'm like hoping to get into all of it. If you don't mind, the people that are here, I'd love to meet you and learn a little bit about what you're working on. So if you could put it in the chat, I would love to like a one sentence description of like what you're working on right now and what you're hoping to get out of this conversation, like any questions you have ahead of time, like anything you're super curious about. Like, I'd love it if you just put it in the chat and I'll reference it where I can. So I'm going to start sharing. I have a quick deck I want to run through with all of you. So some questions I hope to be answered during this conversation is like, when should startups raise? How long does it typically take to raise and find funding? How else can you fund your startup if it's not going to be through traditional like investing and VC routes and stuff? What to do if a VC or an investor like reaches out to you? How do you handle that? Pros and cons of that, and tons more. So if you have questions or stuff that you're curious about, again, put in the chat. I want to answer them and to the best of that I can. So a little bit about me. It was briefly mentioned, but I run a startup accelerator. So I work with founders who are starting their businesses. I've worked with founders who have explored a variety of different ways of financing their business, from bank loans to grants to raising money and more. I also manage a program for aspiring investors. So I'm on the other side of that table too. I help people land a job in venture capital through the work at Chicago Blend. So through my work at Future Founders, I've helped founders that have collectively generated over $140 million in revenue, created over 1,000 jobs. And the work I do with Chicago Blend is sponsored by Melinda Gates because Chicago Blend's mission is gender equity, specifically in venture. So we want to bring underrepresented talent into venture in hopes of making the tech ecosystem more diverse. So I have experience on both fronts. I've awarded over $100,000 in grants and prize money over my career. I run these programs. I also made my first angel investment this year, so I'm really excited about that, which I will talk briefly about later. And I'm also like a really big Elden Ring fan. So if anyone's like playing Elden Ring right now, I'd love to hear about that. So with that, let's get into our discussion. So the fundraising journey, there's different stages of a startup, and there's different like funding or how you seek funding changes as your startup evolves. And the purposes of this discussion, I'm gonna turn like the fundraising and finding money conversation into two parts. First part is for finding money as a pre-seed company. So if you're pre-seed, if you're still searching for product market fit, you probably don't have an MVP, you're probably building no really big sales or anything like yet or anything like that yet, you're still in search of a solution. At around that seed or series A part, you have an MVP, you are actively creating value for people. That means users, revenue, those kind of things. And you are looking for an investment to help scale up those operations. A lot of founders do not raise money at a pre-seed level. They just bootstrap, get that validation, and then raise money at seed series A. Depending on your type of business and depending on how you want to run your business, you might want to seek funding at that pre-seed level. And that's the kind of stuff I want to cover with you all today. So we're going to talk about all of it. Again, if there's anything specific you want to get out of this conversation, put it in the chat. I want to make sure I get to that. So jumping right in, what do pre-seed funding opportunities look like? You're in search of a solution. You don't have that product market fit yet. Like, can you raise money? What does finding money look like? And the first thing I want to cover is angels, angel investors. A lot of founders like want to raise money and think that they need to raise money from VCs, but it's more so that they're looking for an angel. It's probably more appropriate for them to raise money from the angel. And a lot of the reason for that is because a lot of what angels like tend to invest significantly earlier, and they do that because they're much more motivated like about the founder. So it's a lot more about the relationship, how well you vibe with them. Most are going to be more chill. They're probably retired. It's more of like a game to them. They don't see them getting their money back. Again, they're just either like really inspired and motivated by like you as the person, or in some cases, the space, the industry. They're really passionate about crypto or electronic vehicles or sports tech or whatever. And they just want to fund stuff really early in those spaces. A lot of them are really casual because to be like more professional angel, you kind of have to have like a lot more money. There are those more professional like angel individuals or groups that operate more like a VC. You'll encounter those too. But angels are typically like much smaller. And founders, again, like at this pre-seed level, if you're looking for money from an institution or an outside person, like an angel is probably more your route than a traditional VC. With that said, if people have questions about angels or seeking angels, like again, like put in the chat, I want to get to it. In the meantime, I'm going to be moving on. The other opportunity for you to get money at this level is through grants. I love grants. We give grants away at Future Founders all the time. And grants are like a low key, like great way to raise money at this stage. You don't have to give up equity, and they're way easier to get compared to traditional angels or venture capitalists. There's tons of grants, there's free money. There's probably grants at their pitch competitions within your school. There's Future Founders used to host a pitch competition for collegiate entrepreneurs. So there's tons of different ways to make money. The other thing that these awards and grants will do is they'll offer more than just the money. They'll offer support systems, mentors, advisors. They'll introduce you to peers and other founders from the community, which is like a great thing to get immersed in. So don't forget about the grants. They're kind of like the scholarships of startups. It's definitely helpful to like get involved there and try to seek funding that way, as opposed to like giving up equity and control to an angel. I want to share a brief story. So Ariana Edwards is a founder I got to work with last year in my accelerator. And she raised $60,000 just from grants and pitch competitions alone. It took her 2 years. She just went around the circuit. She's the founder of Viola Shoes, which is basically offers extended shoe sizes for women, specifically for like the heels and like more professional shoe category. And she just went around the pitch circuit. She has amazing talent in pitching, amazing at telling a story. She had no product. All she had was like some mock-ups and a really good pitch. And she raised 60 grand. And she just launched last month with the marketplace. She's got 60 grand in a bank, no equity given up, a great wait list and a great community. And now she has a product, which is a no-code product. She launched an e-commerce store, and she's got no overhead. So this is like an amazing foundation for her to start her business. She's still in her early 20s, so she's still young. She did a great job like raising the money over the 2 years. So this is possible for you too. You don't have to try and find an investor, outside investor. You can just do pitch competitions and grants and raise tons of money that way. I definitely recommend you check out Ariana, maybe follow her on LinkedIn. The other opportunity you have at this stage is through crowdfunding. This is kind of like a newer channel that we're seeing. A lot of founders and startups are exploring this. And in many cases, you don't have to give up equity. Kickstarter is like a great opportunity for this. It's also a great way to test and validate the market at this pre-seed stage. So do people actually want to buy your product or service? A tool like Kickstarter can really help you figure that out. Other tools, there's other crowdfunding tools like Honeycomb, which is more of like a loan or like equity crowdfunding type of services. And with services like that, like you can raise money from your biggest fans. So if you already have like a huge customer base, you can then go to them and like ask them for an investment. It's like a really cool opportunity. So that is where I found my first angel investment. And that's what the first investment I made was through a company that I know that wanted to do a crowdfunding round on Honeycomb, which I'll talk about more. So another story for you, another founder we were able to work with at Future Founders is Shannon here, and she's the founder of Zixtix. So she validated her product through Kickstarter. What she offered was this like wooden toys for children that like really encouraged like creativity and building at a really young age. And so she was like, her question was like, do people want this? So she made an MVP, she had toys, she priced it out. She's like, okay, I can make this much money for this amount. And she put it up on Kickstarter, told her story, and she ended up generating almost $12,000 in revenue from parents who really were inspired by the toy for their children, and they went and bought it. She got 184 people to purchase her product. So this was incredibly validating for her. She didn't have to raise any money or give up any outside equity. Another founder I want to talk to you about is Danielle. So she was recently featured on Oprah Daily and Good Morning America. And she did that Honeycomb service where she raised money from her biggest fans, from her customers. And she raised over $40,000. This is her page. And she was already generating revenue. So she's a revenue generating business. She's selling her cookies all the time. And she was going to get featured in Good Morning America and needed like an influx in capital to like help with all that demand and like traction she was going to get. So she raised money. She put in the loan deals like through this service called Honeycomb. It offers like a 10% interest rate on her investment, and set her goal and then gave the terms so people can like go in here and like see what the terms are and stuff. And she was able to get like 55 people. One of those was me. This is the first investment I made because I've just been like a big supporter for throughout her entire like entrepreneurial journey. I love her cookies. I'm obsessed with them. And so she asked and I was like, this sounds like a great opportunity. So you can also go this route as well. So some crowdfunding cheat codes. If you decide to go through this route, some things that I've learned observing people like Shannon and Danielle and many others who've done this like crowdfunding system, it's really helpful to already start capturing sales and getting commitments before you launch this like public campaign. And people recommend already having like 40 to 60% of like your goal already kind of committed on the back end. So when you launch the campaign, you just send them the link and then they like purchase it through the campaign. And this is why you see people like brag about like, oh, we met our goal within 24 hours or within 3 hours, we already met our goal and this and that. It's really catchy because a lot of that work is done beforehand, before the thing gets public. You can use that as like momentum to kind of like sell the story and drive the story, which makes for really good PR too. So this is the other recommendation that founders have is like, don't rely on like tools like Kickstarter or Honeycomb to like show your campaign to other people. Your job as the founder, the person running the campaign, is to bring people to the campaign. So having a PR strategy, a media strategy, a social media strategy to just get people to show up to your campaign is really important. Speaking for Danielle, she emailed me and texted me constantly, just reminding me about the campaign, letting me know that it was happening. She kept me in a loop. This is what's going on. So that when it launched, I was already briefed. I was already ready to invest, which really helped the narrative of her raise. So just a couple cheat codes for you to do. So that is our pre-seed opportunities. I can expand on any of those. Again, I encourage you to put questions in the chat. I'm happy to expand on any of that, add more color, or answer questions, or help any of you with anything that was talked about there. I'm going to move on to talk about seed and Series A fundraising opportunities. So these are for founders and startups who are already growing. They already have product market fit. They have the MVP. They're creating value. They probably have revenue already. They should definitely or be very close to it. And so there's three parts. I like to say that there's like a part zero to this whole process and navigating this whole process. So the first thing I want to talk about quickly is the prep. Now this is where I'm going to put my VC hat on, my Chicago Blend hat on. So when I work with my program of aspiring investors, this is what I'm telling them. It's their job to talk to founders. They are talking and should be talking to like 200 or 500 founders like a year. Those can just be that, and just because they're talking to founders doesn't mean that they're going to invest. A lot of these investors don't really like risk despite being in a very risky space. So your job as a founder is to make your startup feel as the lowest risk thing ever. Generally as a founder, like take mixed signals as a no, just like in dating. If there's mixed signals, it's probably like that they're not interested. You want to work with people who are enthusiastic, who are really excited about you and what you're building. And for your own mental health, just move on if you're not really feeling that. Ultimately, good deals are insanely competitive in the venture capital market. If there's a good deal, like VCs will race and like try to get in there and be really excited and like be very competitive about getting into a deal with a founder. So if you're not generating that type of hype, you're going to get those mixed signals and that weird stuff, and you just don't need to deal with it. So a little bit of color to that side of things. You might also just get a no that has absolutely nothing to do with you. There's a lot of like, and you might not get like a real answer. Here's just a couple like examples of some stuff that like could cause a no that has nothing to do with you. Ultimately, like, you know, don't take the no's like so personally. And kind of just like, you're going to have tons of conversations with tons of investors. So just move on and have like a great list, a great outreach list to start. So this is a question I get asked all the time, which is when do you know that you're ready to begin raising money from traditional venture capital? It's okay to not be ready. You do not have to rush into this process. In fact, it's way better for you to not rush into it for many reasons that I'll talk about later. But it's okay if you don't check off these boxes, it's okay to go back and seek funding from angels or the crowdfunding route or even like the grants route to help get your business to this stage that I'm about to talk to you about. So don't feel like you have to rush. Don't feel like you have to get in there. You could take your time and just focus on like the foundations of your business. So with that said, how do you know that you're ready? You should have like an MVP or a product that is generating value for people. And that's how you have that's basically like the clear product market fit there. Another thing that really helps here is having like a repeatable method of adding users or customers. So like, how are people joining your service? How are people using your app? How are people like purchasing your cookies in Danielle's case? And it really helps if this is like an unpaid channel. So are people just like sharing this by word of mouth because your product is so valuable? Do you have this like strong content marketing campaign where people are just finding you through Google all the time? Do you have this like wildly successful social media thing going for you? Like whatever it is, make sure it's repeatable, because that's what your investors are going to invest in. They're investing your solution, but they're also investing like your marketing channels and your acquisition channels and all that kind of stuff. So if it's repeatable, chances are if you throw more money at it, it's going to grow and it's going to get better. So that's how you know you really have something special and that you could take that to go and raise. The other thing that's really helpful here is understanding like your metrics and your KPIs. How do you understand, like, how are you driving value? How are you driving, creating value for users and customers? So with that, to expand on this point on KPIs, you want to be really careful about vanity metrics. I see a lot of founders, you know, brag and get really excited about, you know, total downloads. You know, our total user base is in the hundreds of thousands. If those people aren't engaging, if they're not excited or getting value from your service, that really doesn't mean anything. So there's other KPIs that are better, like daily active users, like DAU here. Revenue is always like a really important substantive KPI. Lifetime value of a customer, returning customers are really good KPIs. If you're not familiar, a North Star metric is also really important to have. A North Star metric is basically like one stat that you can just obsess over as a company that you know if this stat grows, like you are driving value for more and more people. So if you're a social media site, that North Star is like daily active users. If you're Danielle's case, that North Star is revenue or cookies sold. every decision in your company should be made in pursuit of like growing that number more and more. And I've included more resources and documents to expand and add some more color to like metrics and KPIs for startups. Other things you should definitely know and be familiar with as you begin prepping for this fundraising process is the certain like unit economics like of your business. So how much does it cost to acquire a customer or a user? What is the cost of your goods, or like how much does it cost to make your good or service? Like in Danielle's case, like how much does it cost to make a bag of cookies? How much does she sell them for? How much does it cost to market those cookies and gain a customer? These are all numbers that you should just like have ready and are constantly thinking about. Churn is something you'll hear about a lot, especially in SaaS startups, software as a service startups, which means how many people bought your service and then left. So how many people are leaving your service? How many people like didn't come back? Because that's a sign that they were interested and they were like, they were committed and they pulled out your credit card, their credit card, but they weren't getting the value and you weren't meeting their expectations. So churn is like a big signal of like a red flag if the numbers like aren't satisfying. Churn is also natural. So it's definitely something to pay attention to though, because it could get problematic. What are your certain conversion metrics? You know, if you launched a social media ad campaign, how confident are you that you can convert, you know, X amount of people? How many of those people convert to like paying customers? How many people add to cart and then check out at the end too? Those are really important people. How many people go to your site and then leave your site and never browse or never do anything? These are really helpful signals that you have something special. And then the last thing I want to mention is a magic number. So magic numbers are like weird data points that are different for every business that show a lot are very important in the overall success or value of the product. And the best example of this that I've come across is Twitter. So when Twitter was starting out, they discovered that if somebody followed at least 34 people on Twitter, that they were like 80 to 90% more likely to turn into a daily active user on Twitter. If they did not follow at least 34 people, they were significantly likely to never open the app and then download the and then deleted the app later on. And so that was Twitter's magic number. So their whole mission then was, once somebody downloads the app, we want to make sure that they're following at least 34 people. That's their magic number. So what they did was they designed the product to then show people when they were signing up and creating their account for Twitter, all of, like recommended people to follow. You might have remembered seeing that screen when you signed up for Twitter. The reason they did that is because they want you to follow at least 34 people. Whereas before, that feature didn't exist. They didn't even tell you or recommend anybody to follow. That was just out there. But that number told them to like prioritize that feature and put it up front during the sign up process. And so that was Twitter's magic number. That 34 might mean nothing to you. It might mean nothing to your business. But there's certain weird quirks or things that kind of happen that just make people more engaged or drive more value or just be that critical point that is really important for a business. So what is your magic number? Do you have one? What is it? Look for it, find it, and prioritize it. Another question we get asked all the time with future founders is, how much should a startup raise? So let's say you have all this, you're really confident, you're ready to raise, how much do you ask for? This is kind of like, the answer kind of depends, but a couple of questions to kind of consider, a couple of points to consider is that it's always easier to add more money to your round than it is to like take away money for your round. So you do want to kind of like undershoot or like whatever number it is, kind of put it lower, but that number should definitely be enough for you to get to the next phase of your business. So founders will typically raise money to allow for like 12 to 18 months of runway. This money is typically used for like salaries, any paid forms of customer acquisition costs, legal fees, tons of legal fees, and like space. So all those things considered, like all this money can provide like 12 to 18 months of business support. And then after that, it's like time to raise again, or you're one of the few but special startups that only need to raise once, because you were able to take the money and start generating enough revenue where you don't need to raise again. So consider that when you decide to like decide like how much to raise. So that's your prep work. So that's everything you do to like have a successful raise beforehand. And a lot of that has to do with just having a healthy business, finding that product market fit, getting your house in order, you know, figuring out the certain stats and math that you need to like be successful. So I call that step zero, which is the prep, which is just basically having a good, healthy startup. Assuming you have a healthy, good startup, then we can get into the next three steps of raising money. So the actual process of it, what does that entail? The actual negotiations part of it, which is an oftentimes underlooked part of this process, and then closing and what happens next. So we're gonna get into each of these. If you have any questions, want to know anything more specific, put it in the chat again. So before we get into talking about the process, I do feel like this is a good moment to acknowledge entrepreneurial privilege. And entrepreneurial privilege doesn't always have to do with race or gender. We see report on data like this in Chicago Blend that there's tons of discrimination that women and people of color face when they try raising a fund. That stuff is definitely real, but I also want to expand that and say that like entrepreneurial privilege doesn't always have to do with that. Sometimes it could be as simple as, you know, being able to live with your parents so you don't have to pay rent and you can focus on your startup full time. Not everybody has that opportunity. Or do you have a partner that has health insurance that you can be added to so that way you don't have to pay for health insurance through your startup? That is something that you can take advantage of. Do you have a large social capital because of the network that you're involved in? Like all of these things make the entrepreneurial process easier or harder depending on what you do or don't have. With that said, like venture, it still has a lot of room to grow when it comes to investing in underrepresented founders. So if you fall into those categories, it is going to be tougher for you. It's not impossible. There is still hope. There is a lot of room to grow though still in the industry. So if you are one of these founders and you like, I do encourage you to kind of check out some of these resources here. There's some like personalities that I really enjoy who share a lot of like content on raising as an underrepresented founder, specifically Lolita Taub. She puts out a lot of content like this. She has a fund specifically dedicated for investing in underrepresented founders. Arlen here is also like pretty great. She's on Twitter. Backstage Capital, Harlem Capital are two big leaders right now in just investing in our underrepresented founders. So I do encourage you to check those things out. Future Founders and Chicago Blend are also very dedicated to supporting underrepresented founders and investors. So do give us a follow and check out our stuff too. Some other personalities and stuff I really enjoy. Kara Swisher, she's a tech journalist. So she covers like all things tech, but she's a big, strong advocate for gender diversity in tech. And then Emily Chang wrote this great book called Brotopia, which really uncovers like the gender disparities in tech, not just with startups and raising money, but just expanding it broadly to include like engineering and stuff too. So I say all this to say that like, this stuff is very important to acknowledge. There is a lot of room to grow, especially on the investor angle, but as a founder, you have to be good at solving problems. So it's important to like understand what privilege you have and have access to versus the stuff you don't, because some of the stuff can be solved for. I was a founder who did not have strong social capital. I came from a family of immigrants. So there's not like, you know, family members I can go to ask for advice. So I ended up doing this program called IHCC, which was a Hispanic incubator for just Hispanic founders. And that was able to like grow my network. It's something that helped me find this job here at Future Founders. So there's programs that are just for underrepresented founders. I encourage you to check that stuff out. There's grants just for underrepresented founders. So I want to like acknowledge that like raising money, there's like horror stories of women and people of color and this like obstacles they face. But there's also like people who've dedicated their careers to supporting these founders as well. So don't give up hope, but there is a lot of room to grow. There is a question in the chat, so I'm going to get into the process, but first I want to acknowledge this question. Is there fundraising before seed funding? Yes, I did briefly cover like pre-seed funding. So for you working on a biotech convention, I'm imagining there's going to be tons of like grants for you, like, you know, federal grants, like even school grants. I know a lot of founders who work on hard tech stuff that kill it at the pitch competition circuit. So I do think like grants are a big route. Also, like angels would be pretty good for your category as well. If you were able to network your way into finding like an angel who's really invested in biotech, that would be like beneficial too. So I do recommend that kind of stuff. I covered it briefly in the beginning. This is recorded. You can revisit it. Towards the end of this conversation, you can unmute and we can like have a discussion, a deeper discussion about this too. But yeah, I'm going to keep moving on. If you have more questions, keep putting them in. Thanks for posting that one. So with that said, we're talking about the process of raising money. So I also want to talk briefly about pitch decks. I am going to come back and do a session on pitching and storytelling. And I'm going to expand on pitch decks further there. But I want to briefly talk about pitch decks because it's a big part of raising money. So I'm going to just give like a surface level. If you want to know more, you can ask questions about it, or you can show up to the other session that's happening later in the semester. So there's like a bit of like competing advice. I want to share like everything with you guys, and then you can kind of decide like what works for you. Some founders I've talked to like they recommend not sending pitch decks via email. A lot of times you'll get VCs or investors be like, yeah, send me a pitch deck. I'll take a look. Veteran founders that I've talked to are like, don't send that pitch deck. Get them on a call so you can walk them through that pitch deck so they can hear the story and excitement and details live. That's like a cop-out. Like, don't give them that opportunity. You want to control the narrative. Other founders are like, well, hold on, make two separate pitch decks. Keep the nice short one for like that you can like pitch with separate, but also create one with more detail that adds a little bit more color to areas when you don't have the opportunity to pitch to investors. So I've seen people do both. Ultimately, like it's what ends up working for you. But veteran founders have like really tried to move away from, like are really trying to do better by like controlling the narrative. I'm just gonna dump like a bunch of like pitch deck resources for you all. So Angel Match, Open Deck are just databases of pitch decks sorted by industry, stage. So I wouldn't be surprised if you can find like a biotech one on there of somebody who's raised a seed round or a pre-seed round for like a biotech company. If you just like go on those databases, you can see like what worked for them and how much money they were able to raise. I love, love, love Airbnb's pitch deck. They're kind of like the model startup for just everything startup related. So their pitch deck is definitely like worth a visit. There's some really fun ones too. Like you can see what Fyre Festival used to raise money, which is kind of fun looking back on it. And then Facebook's and Uber's are also available publicly as well. All of this stuff will be shared in advance. I do encourage you to check it all out and find what works for you. Another founder I want to introduce you to is Murtaza. He founded this online community tool called Heartbeat, essentially a more engaging Discord for online communities. And he recently raised and closed a pre-seed round. He was trying to raise $600,000. He ended up raising almost $800,000. And I want to show you two slides from his pitch deck that if you take anything away from this conversation, pitch deck related, I want you to pay attention to this. So again, he's starting this online community. Two slides that I really think are special, and I'm going to explain why, is his traction slide. This is the slide he used in his pitch deck to raise almost $800,000. A lot of things are happening here, and I'm going to walk through each of them. These four stats are incredibly important. There's a lot of things going on with these stats. He's able to show his product market fit and like the traction he has so far. So he onboarded 10 communities. Those 10 communities are paying customers. This monthly recurring revenue number is really special. So we know that like people are purchasing this. So this is a little bit of a safer investment. He's already revenue generating. And then what I love too is this third stat that he's talking to and potentially has $15,000 more a month in the pipeline just based on people that he's talking to or it just hasn't closed yet. And what I love about this is he included that 100% of these people are inbound, which means he is not going out paying for Google ads or asking people to buy his service or anything. All that is coming to him, which shows the strength of his network and like the strength of his product, more importantly. So that's like a cool signal there. And then finally is kind of the engagement question, the value question, like almost 80% of his customers stay engaged beyond 30 days. This is a clear sign that he's like creating value. He also has these testimonials here from some of his customers. And then the most important thing on this entire slide is that he provided context through time. So all of this has happened within 6 months. This is huge. A lot of founders skip this step, but it's such an important part of the narrative of what you're building. You always want to provide context through time. Because what this tells me is, like, as an investor, if you were able to do this in 6 months, in 12 months, I can see all these numbers double or even triple or grow from there. This is momentum. This is like showing that, you know, the rocket's taking off, things are happening. It shows he's action oriented, that they're great at getting stuff done. And so whatever you're doing, whether you have these fancy numbers or not, if you just provide like context through time and just being like, you know, I had 100 customer discovery interviews in a week. We're getting 2,000 website visitors a month. Just providing that extra like data point about the time really, really helps to kind of make projections. So that brings me to his second slide that I really love, which is his ask slide. So he's raising his money to get to 1,000 communities in 12 months, to get to almost $2 million in annual recurring revenue, and to onboard 16 members. And these stats are a lot more believable when he already has data like this. So if you're a startup, if you're raising money, you know, this is about pitch decks, but this also kind of just expands generally, is have stats like this. This is like an amazing narrative. It's incredibly powerful. So that's some notes on pitch decks. If you want me to expand on anything, put it in the chat. The other part I want to get to is a lot of questions that founders ask is like, okay, so do you have all this stuff ready? You have your pitch deck, you have a really healthy startup with all these important metrics, you're ready to go. What do you actually do next? How do you actually get money and get checks in your bank account? So what a lot of founders will tell you is you're gonna have a lot of conversations. You're gonna wanna compile just basically a huge database of VCs who their investment criteria matches what your startup is doing. And document how you plan on getting in touch with them. Who is going to introduce you? Who do you need to get to know to make that introduction? Just document how you're going to reach out. And the other important part is you need to understand momentum. Veteran founders who've raised before, who it's their second time raising money, third time raising money, will tell you that a lot of the raising money process has to do with momentum. That's why Murtaza on this other slide put the 6 months here. And that's why a lot of founders will tell you, like, schedule all of your initial meetings as close as possible. This helps down the line when you can get like VCs to compete against each other, which means you get better terms on your deal. And it provides this like fear of missing out that make investors run to deals and like make them really excited about deals. If they see that other people are interested in, that's going to light a fire under their ass and like get you to commit, like they're going to commit or respond to your emails or like get you that check faster. This is an art. It's not a science. We have suggestions, but a lot of this like is this part that's like not talked about enough. And as somebody who's running, you know, a program for founders who raise money and for people who want to be investors, I'm giving you all the cheat codes here. So try to schedule as many of those meetings as close together as possible. How long does it take? It depends. People usually set aside 2 to 3 months out of the year to do this. It usually ends up being like their main thing. So this is why it's great to have a team, because the rest of your team can keep the business running and keep the lights on while you, the primary founder, go out and raise the money. So it's a huge process. It's a full-time thing. Quick story. So Claire Coder is another founder we've worked with at Future Founders. She provides tampons for public restrooms. So you know how like there's the toilet paper, there's soap, there's the water, there's everything. She also provides a box of tampons in public restrooms. So when she raised her round, it took her 86 meetings to close just over $1 million. Tons of time was spent on this. Her database and stuff is huge. It's crazy. Some other crazy stats about her raise here's some other like interesting stats that she shared that I'm going to share with all you too. So the most number of meetings that she had for an investor to just say no, like 9. So 9 meetings with an investor to just get a no at the end is brutal. least number of meetings to get a yes was just one. That happened too. She lost count after spending 150 hours on this whole process, and which is not does not include like the emailing, back and forth, scheduling, all that stuff. Her mean check size ended up being 75K. She got about 30 people that said no for now, but come back later, which is a really popular answer that you got to be ready for. And then she ended up spending like $25,000 to $55,000 just on legal bills. So this process is a beast. You got to get, you know, your head right for it. Sorry, we're glitching again. I'm looking at the question in the chat. All right, great question. So we get this question a lot at Future Founders is like, you know, how do you be protective? What are you protective over when it comes to like the stuff under the hood with your startup? In this case, with the biotech stuff, with this being like a hard tech company, founders, you have a little bit more of a right to be protective over like the specific like innovation. If there's like a specific thing that, you know, makes your biotech company really special, something really hardware related, something really like math related, I do think that that's worth being a little bit more protective over. But just generally, we really advise founders to like not have investors sign NDAs or any of that. You need to tell people the reality of your startup. You need to be honest. You need to brag. You need events. You need to do all that. So just as a general thing, as this applies outside of this question, we typically tell founders to not be that protective. With that said, there are exceptions, like for a hard tech situation, where it does make sense to be a little bit more protective if there's something specific with the innovation. Something that you would, if you think there's value in patenting it, then I would say like don't share that. So with that said, like how much science to include? I'd say like just about enough, like for them to understand like where the value is coming from. But definitely this is kind of like the art of it, of like, if they want to know more, they have to commit more, or they have to be a right fit. You have to be excited about them. Kind of like dating, like you don't want to give up, like a lot of people don't want to give up the goods like right away. They kind of have to like earn that a little bit more. So like, I would say that holds true a little bit too for investors. Like you want to make sure that they're excited and they're not just doing like competitor research on your biotech startup because they funded a competitor. I don't think your senior professor needs to be involved unless they specifically ask. It's important to acknowledge that you have them. I would make them like a formal advisor or something, put them on your team slide, all that stuff. But the VC will ask on their own when they think it's like appropriate to like talk to them. But I definitely don't think they need to be on those first meetings. The first meetings are typically the investor just like chatting with you just to like see if it's even worth talking, like having a deeper conversation. Do you match their investment criteria? Like, do you have the green flags that they need to see? You'll get no's a lot within the first meeting, which are great. Move on with your life. But those first meetings like are usually really, really quick. Founders can do them, like veteran founders can do them in like 20, 30 minutes. You don't need to like do a whole thing. Hopefully that answers your question. I wouldn't give up too much of the science up front. That'll be more for you. Like, are you comfortable sharing that? Like, are you excited about this investor? Do you think they're actually going to invest? Without knowing who you're talking to or like the details and like social aspect of it. That's kind of just like my quick general answer. But that, I hope that helps. Yep. All right. So quick note, all right, so we were chatting about just the beast that is raising. So Onflow, crazy story, lots of work goes into this. And this is pretty average. You can expect numbers like this for yourself if you ever decided to raise too. I mentioned that you're gonna have to ask for intros a lot, which is pretty common. Don't be afraid to ask for intros. It's part of the job. In some cases, people get paid for successfully sourcing a company to a VC. I pay my fellows for Chicago Blend. If one of my fellows successfully gets a deal, like we will pay them for that. So people love making deals happen. Don't feel weird about like asking for an introduction to a VC. If you have a good reputation, people will be excited to do that. If you have a bad reputation, then we have to focus on that. But if you have a good reputation, like, people will help you. Don't worry too much about that. Here's like some articles and stuff on like how to do that. Here's like some sample copy on like how to do it. You know, you just kind of say like personal note up here. It's just like, yo, great seeing you at this event. We're going to, you know, be raising. I see you're connected to these people and these people. This is why I want to talk to them. Definitely put a lot of personalization into this. Would you be comfortable making these introductions? Totally fair question. If they're not comfortable or they don't feel like their relationship with that VC is that strong, that's okay. You'll find another and you can move on. The other thing is like, you know, here's the deck or here's like a blurb of what we're working on really quick. Here's the clip notes. Here's what's going on. And what's going to happen is whoever you sent this to is going to forward this email to that investor and be like, hey, I talked to this founder recently. They're trying to raise. Would you be interested in having a conversation with them? Let me know if I can set up the introduction. Then that investor is going to reply, hey, they sound really cool. Yes, make the intro happen. To that end, then they're going to start a separate chain, introducing you via email. You follow up, make that meeting happen. That's usually how these things go. This is just good practice for asking for introductions for anything outside of raising money too. I recommend you all follow a similar model for anything outside of raising money. I make introductions for my founders all the time. It's part of the process. Emails like this, great. Feel free to kind of just like rip this one for one. So with that said, what happens if a VC reached out to you before you're ready to raise? Should you take that meeting? This happens all the time. If somebody's reached out to any of you so far, please put it in the chat. Please put it in the chat if like a VC emailed, cold emailed you. I'd love to hear it and hear that story. This happens a lot. Founders get very excited. Like, it is an exciting thing. Like, it's kind of fun. I will tell you that, again, like, don't get too excited because like it is their jobs. Like, if you got any media coverage at all, and I'm talking like even if you were accepted to any incubator or accelerator and your name is on some list somewhere that says you're a founder, chances are it's an associate's job to like literally find that and like email you about it. And again, that first meeting doesn't mean that they're going to invest. That first meeting is just like to acknowledge that they've interacted with you and just kind of like see if you check some boxes. The first meeting isn't as special as like the second, third, and like due diligence stuff. So what should you do? Here's an argument to take the meeting. One, people will tell you it's an opportunity to build relationships with investors. You get to kind of meet them. Investors will tell you that they could provide value for you. They might be able to introduce you to another founder for mentorship. They might be able to introduce you to this person who did this cool Google Ads campaign that can help you. All that is fair. It may or may not happen, TBD. Other reasons to say no to these meetings is a lot of veteran founders will tell you it's a distraction. You should be focusing on building the business. If you're not really actively raising, it kind of just serves as a distraction. It takes up too much time. When you're ready to raise, they're going to take your meeting anyway. They're not going to say no. So there's really no like hard reason to like build that relationship up front, because you're going to get the meeting regardless. If you're raising and they're a good fit, you're going to get the meeting. So you don't have to spend a ton of time on it. The other thing that veteran founders will say is, back to this momentum piece, you get to control the narrative of your startup. There's a lot of dirty laundry that will be shared, or I don't want investors to know about like the struggles that I've had or the problems I've had. You know, when I'm ready to raise, I want all positivity, all green lights, all that stuff all the time. And if I took this meeting 6 months before I was ready to raise and they were put on as some struggles I was having, that might hurt my raise when I'm actually ready. So it could be beneficial to be a little bit more protective of that information. Here's an email I got. This happened to me and a couple of times. This is the first time it happened. Somebody reached out because they saw I was a part of this IHCC accelerator, which was the Hispanic accelerator that I was part of for one of my startups. They reached out, this is an associate. Hey, this is who I am, would love to chat with you. Here's some more info about our firm. I politely declined and said like, thanks for reaching out. Would love to connect. I'm just not ready to raise right now. Happy to reach out when I'm ready to raise. And look who responds, the partner responds. So not the associate anymore, the partner responds saying like, totally cool. You know, we just want to like talk to people over time, looking forward to it when the time is right. I can guarantee you that there's a record of me in their system, that they still have a record of me in their system. So when I am ready to raise, they're going to see this and they're going to respond to my email. We already have a relationship. There's already a record of me in there just by just declining them because they reached out because it's a part of their internal CRM system. So whether I have 50 meetings with them or just this one interaction, they still know who I am. And I don't need to spend all that time like building that relationship. I'll just reach out when the time's right. And then you can learn about what I'm doing. So I understand it's hard to kind of say no. And like, it seems like counterproductive. If you want to say yes, like go for it. This is like, again, an art, not a science. I just want to share different schools of thoughts. You know, investors might actually be really cool and you could get like a really great buy with them and they could actually provide value. Who's to say? But I just want to kind of share this information with you all so you can all make the best, most informed decisions. The one thing cooler than getting a VC to reach out to you from a meeting is denying a VC a meeting. So consider that. Other thing I would encourage you all to do is just engage in the culture and the humor a little bit too. This is an Instagram account called Crane for Exits, which I love, which is just like VC humor for founders. There's a lot of like nonsense and posturing and just like weird stuff that VCs will do. And this is like a community and page run by founders. I encourage you to get in on these memes. They're really fun. And they kind of just like humanize like these big scary investors like a lot. They're not as special as you think they are. So engage in the culture, have fun with this humor. I totally recommend this account. So moving on. We're going to now talk about negotiations. I want to take a brief pause there for any more questions. We are almost wrapped up. I have been sharing a lot. I'm happy to expand on anything I've talked about so far before we get into the next two parts. Anybody have anything? Okay. Depend in the chat or interrupt me. So we talked about the prep. What needs to happen with your startup beforehand. We talked about the process of what it actually takes to raise money. Now we're going to talk about the negotiation part, which is another not talked about part of raising money. People focus on the pitch, the meetings, all that stuff. But what happens when you actually get interest and you actually start exchanging some term sheets? What do you do there? When you enter negotiations and you start exchanging term sheets, there's only two things that matter. Price or control. These are the only two things that matter when you enter the negotiation and it's time to close a deal. Every decision that's made, every email that's exchanged is all about balancing this. You could have one of these or you can have the other. You as a founder need to like really get familiar with this and really understand what you're willing to give up for what cost. So the price of your startup is basically determined by how much is invested and at what evaluation. You're going to hear a lot of terminology. A book I recommend that really helps for this part of the process is this book called Venture Deals. There's a lot of vocab, there's a lot of jargon, you know, pre-money, post-money, non-dilutive equity, dilutive equity, cap tables, like just tons of stuff. I don't have enough time to like share all that stuff with you today. Read Venture Deals, they'll help you. With that said, price is determined by how much is invested at one evaluation. So does an investor's money mean that your company is now worth $2 million, $3 million, $5 million? Like, what does that money mean? The other thing, variable that matters here, is control. So if you take their money, how much control are you giving up? Can they fire you? Can you fire yourself? Like, what decision-making power do you have? Do you have to get their sign-off for XYZ decisions? All of that is determined in negotiations. There's not one, there's like best practices or like stuff that like typically happens, but there's a lot of stuff in the weeds that the lawyers will go back and forth with and you'll end up fighting for that rarely happens at this part. So the good news is, before I get to that, like, you know, we see in the media all the time, like people raising tons of money from like ridiculous money. And one thing I hope you understand from this point is like to not get distracted by these big fancy numbers. Like, you do not know what the terms of their agreements were. You don't know how much control they had to give up to get these big fancy numbers. They could have like given up complete control and complete authority to the investors and the board of directors, and made deals that you as a founder for your own thing, like, are not comfortable with. Like, you would not have made that deal. So you don't know like the terms and deals. So don't compare yourself. Just play your game. Just focus on you and what you're doing and think about yourself and what you are willing to give up for what price. All of these headlines were I screenshotted today, by the way. So this is just stuff from today of what's happening there on TechCrunch. So understand, so the good news here is that you typically only have to negotiate with like one firm. The lead investor, who's the investor that puts in the most money in the round, is going to determine the terms for everybody else. So you don't have to negotiate like eight different times for your eight different investors. You basically have to negotiate once with the person who's leading around. That's the good news. The other good news is if you're a healthy startup, again, back to those, like that prep work we were talking about of having good metrics, having product market fit, that kind of stuff, you're going to have all the power. Again, good startups are like really competitive when it comes to raising money. And that power is going to shift to your category if you actually have something really substantive. So make sure you go back to the drawing board and just build like a strong startup if you want to do well and want to get a good deal. That's an underlooked part. Ultimately, the startups that don't need to raise are gonna ultimately be the ones that have the best deals. If you're just like desperate for cash and you already burned through your savings and you're just like really desperate to get a deal, you're gonna get like a really bad term and you're gonna have to give up a lot of control. You don't have power in that situation, so you're gonna miss out. So definitely understand, like, kind of like, you have strong emotional intelligence around this. Understand negotiation dynamics, understand power dynamics, like when you go get into this part. Again, the good news is you only have to do this like one firm, but you could still get like really great deals, like if you have like a healthy startup. Read venture deals. Here is the book. It's $30 on Amazon. They're going to tell you all the different terms. They're going to share way more about the negotiation stuff, what to fight for, what to give up, what battles to pick, all that. We don't have enough time to get into all that today, but I do want to acknowledge that this is an important part of the fundraising aspect, and founders don't really talk about it. Investors definitely don't talk about it. So get yourself familiar with this stuff. Negotiation only comes down to two things, price versus control. With that said, time to wrap it up. You did the negotiations, you've successfully completed your $1 million pre-seed round or seed round. You have like a really a funded startup. That's an amazing milestone. Congratulations. But things just got significantly harder. Now you have to deliver on those promises. Now you have to hire, and hiring is a huge thing. Now you have to like grow and scale. And a lot of these relationships with investors, like there's some really crazy data on this, but like investor founder relationships end up lasting longer than most marriages. So keep that in mind when you're deciding like who to get in bed with, investor-wise, when you're deciding to like pick the, you know, raise money. The other thing I'll say on this point is like the skills required to validate and like find product market fit are totally different than the skills required to grow an already established startup and grow in revenue. You might have been a founder that's really good at, you know, engaging with users, doing customer discovery, figuring out the MVP and creating value. And you might be a founder that really sucks at scaling and hiring and, running a sales team and human resources and managing like operational stuff and legal stuff. Like that stuff might not be your bread and butter. The skills required to be successful are totally different. A lot of founders get fired, AKA leave to like spend more time with their family because they just don't have what it takes. This is very common. And this is back to like that price versus control thing of like, did you give up control to like fire yourself? Or is that going to be like what your board of directors or investors do? So think about that, but like also like, don't be too hard on yourself. If it turns out that you can't, you know, make it past seed or series A, like it's totally natural to end up hiring a CEO and have somebody external come in and grow the company from there. Very rarely do the original founders like stay within the companies for a really long time. Usually they end up turning out. And like a lot of founders will just exit around this stage or move on and like start something else because they're just really good at that pre-seed seed stage. And that's totally cool too. So keep that in mind. Don't be too hard on yourself. but just know that things get significantly harder after you raise. So there you have it. We covered a lot today. We covered the various means of finding financing for your early stage startups, how to fundraise, and I give you quick details and surface level stuff of each component, and you know, the different parts of the fundraising process, all that stuff. So we covered a lot. I'm really curious, you know, we're at the end of our discussion now, like what else do you guys want to know about? What else do you want me to expand on? I'm happy to, you know, engage in discussion with anybody on this call about anything specific that they've been curious about or are currently going through. I'd love to turn it over to all of you so we can expand on stuff. Okay, Alex, what is a good way to go about the initial incorporation official business registration aspect, especially because we don't have a lot of money for lawyers? Shouldn't this be done before fundraising? Great question, Alex. This is another one we get a lot. So this is gonna be a long answer, but founders oftentimes have to be really good at managing risk. So what that means is, like, do you have to incorporate? Yeah, like maybe. Do you have to like have all your legal ducks in a row? Maybe. Is it risky to not? Of course it is. But is it going to shut down your business and you're going to like blow up in flames? Probably not. And so you have to be comfortable with managing like different types of risk. Your dentist tells you to floss every time you see him, her, or they, right? So, but if you don't floss, are you going to get gingivitis? Probably not. But your dentist is going to tell you to floss all the time anyway. You could never floss, floss sometimes. You're playing with risk there. So one thing I tell founders all the time is, like, when you think about incorporating, a lawyer is going to tell you, you have to do it right away. You have to do it, like, all this stuff. But, like, you're too small to really be that big of a threat or whatever. Like, it is risky, yes. But, like, that's also distraction. It also costs a lot of money, as you noted, to pay for money for lawyers and to get all your legal ducks in a row. So because of that point, I usually recommend founders, like, really kick the can down on all this legal stuff. In very specific scenarios where it has to do with like safety or like really important liability things, they usually kick the can down to when it really makes sense. You don't have to rush to incorporate or any of that. Some angels, some investors, part of the money that they invest, they'll use to pay for those incorporation fees and to get a lot of legal stuff in a row. It's totally okay. Like, it's not a red flag if you don't have the legal stuff together when you go to raise. There's some legal stuff that you should have together, like the term sheets and the deals and like the business entities and stuff. But like, if it's not totally perfect, it's not going to sink your deal. There's other stuff that's like more important. It's more important to have product market fit. It's more important to have revenue, have customers, that kind of stuff. There are exceptions to what I'm saying. I don't know people's specific situations, but just generally, it's kind of okay to kick the can down the road. If you do end up incorporating, investors will tell you to do a C Corp in Delaware. There's a service called Stripe Atlas. If you just Google this, you'll find it. And basically, you can incorporate for $500 and get a C Corp in Delaware. The reason why investors really like that, because it makes like the whatever legal structure that entails makes it really easy to onboard new investors. It's also really cheap and affordable. So through Stripe Atlas, you can do that pretty easily. That's a cool service. You could get a discount through it, like a startup discount, if you qualify, which makes it $250. So some things to know about that. David's question, do you need a CTO before getting funding for a VC for a software app? It depends, which is like kind of like, I know, like an unsatisfying answer. I'm sure there's stories of people, like, it really depends like what you're doing or what you're building. If you need a CTO to like build your app and build your service and you haven't even generated any like value yet, then you're looking for an angel, and an angel may or may not be comfortable spending money on something like that. I'm sure of a lot of investors or angels will tell you that like you need to, you know, have some service or some no code solution or create value in some way. So if you have that taken care of and you're able to create value without having like a custom code, you're way better off at like successfully raising. And then, yeah, part of that funding could be used to hire a CTO to do a very specific like tech task. So David, I really think it depends. Like I could see it going both ways. I think most importantly, if you're able to create value without one and you have customers and you have those important traction numbers and you need a CTO to scale or to do something else, I could see it working out. If you need a CTO to like build your app for you, then you're going to have to, I probably recommend going and looking for grants and doing that whole thing, doing pitch competitions and try to raise money like Ariana did. And then you can use that money to just hire somebody yourself or hire a dev shop or do that kind of thing to help you build your app or whatever. That's kind of my answer to that. Maybe it's unsatisfying, but that's kind of what I've seen. I see those two things for you. All right. Any other questions? Also, feel free to unmute and we can chat more like that too. Here's my Twitter. Here's my email. Here's my Medium. I post stuff pretty frequently, semi-frequently. I also want to share the Future Founders Program, which you all can qualify for. We're going to be recruiting for founders in the winter. So we have some time, but you can sign up for the waitlist to get notified when applications launch. I'm also going to expand on the whole pitching elements of fundraising. I think it's next week or in 2 weeks for the other session with the basement. So I'll be back if you want to show up to that. But yeah, you guys have my info. This recording will be shared. Reach out if you need anything.
Yeah, thank you, Sal. Thank you for your time today. I think it was very valuable information. So thank you for being with us. And yeah, you'll be back with us thinking about a week or so.
Yep.
Yeah, so thank you. I don't think we have any other questions. So we end the webinar for now. But yeah, thank you, Sal, and thank everyone for attending.
Awesome. All right. Thanks, y'all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.